tonight. I certainly look forward with great anticipation to get back to this state of Texas again. And some time ago, when I was in Waterloo, I had come in contact with Brother Lindsay that invited me down to this Voice of Healing convention. Later in Chattanooga, I met our dear friend, Brother David, which also inspired me to come. And to come and have a party in this convention, get to see this people, and so forth. And it was very kind of them to ask me to be their ninth speaker, these 6 nights. I missed one of them by not knowing that it was to be in the afternoon. And I'm sorry of that, because I got in the city too late to even get there for the afternoon speaking. But it's certainly a privilege to be here tonight and to be associated with this Voice of Healing convention. And we're trusting that God will give us that exceedingly abundance of all that we
need. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hearing Brother Xavier just now as we drove up, going over into Finland, I believe. That's wonderful. And we believe that our Lord is coming soon. And we are now just gathering up gleaning from the fields that the horse has been led, like roots in the field, I suppose, gathering up that which is favorable, and God has ordained eternal life. We are trying to gather that up. And I am so glad to know that we live in one of the greatest days that man has ever lived in, just before the coming of the King. This is my third visit to Dallas, I believe. Once was with the minister, I think his name is Brother Goff. We had a little church out here, I'll be over in Dallas proper. And then I come one time to some stadium or something here, or some, I forget what the name of the place was.
Fair Park.
That's exactly right, sir. And then this, I think, is our third time. And we're happy to be here tonight. And minister on through Friday night, the Lord willing. But it certainly does make me feel rather out of place or a little small, and just an old, what would I call in the South, a sack brat preacher? How many know about sack brat?
Oh,
what word can you touch me about? So here we're, and up here to speak before these fine ministers and to be an evening speaker, it certainly makes me feel good. And to think that many of these men here were on the field preaching when I was a sinner boy running horse races around the Boston Ring somewhere, and to know that they made the way clear so that I could run over a smooth road. So I'm grateful for my brethren tonight, and I trust that one little effort that I can put forth that will be a blessing to all, to make the sinner realize that he is a sinner, and to make the saint rejoice in Christ, to make the sick know that there is a healer, and to my brethren to be inspired, that to move forward with greater anticipation than ever before.
Hallelujah.
Now, as I never had yet, I was ordained in the Missionary Baptist Church, and after leaving the Missionary Baptist Church, I have never taken up any affiliation with any churches since, any certain denominations, because I've tried to stand right in the breach between them all and say we're brethren. And I believe that we are brethren. And so therefore I don't represent any certain denominational church, but I represent the church. That's where all of you belong. And that great body of Christ. And we're looking for that day to come when he'll rapture his church and go home.
Oh, yeah.
The Lord willing, this week I want to speak on some of that. And on the top folks is the church going, the handwriting on the wall, and United Under God, and a few things of that type, the Lord willing, in this coming week. Now, I believe that this is the true foundation, the Bible. I believe that God does many things that's not in the Bible. He can do anything because he's God. But I think that doctrine should come out of the Scripture. that is God's book to us. Now, in the Old Testament, they had two or three ways of knowing whether it was truth or not, and that is they would go back to what they call the Urim and Thummim. And that was, I've been told, that was the breastplate that Aaron had that had the 12 stones in it. And then when a prophet prophesied, or a dreamer told his dream, and did not a conglomeration of light flicker on this Urim and Thummim, then the prophet was wrong. See, God always had a way of answering supernatural. See, always the truth is known. So if that would not play, then the prophet was wrong. And now, as that priesthood was done away with, and we have a new priesthood tonight, Jesus Christ being the high priest, we have a new Urim Thummim, and that's the Bible. Yeah. Take away or add to, the same shall be taken from the book of life. Amen. So we're trying our best, but God help us stay right in these pages. I've often said this, I do not want any less than God has in the Bible, but I want all He has in the Bible. Just all the promises that's to us. So before we open His word for our text, let us bow our heads just a moment in prayer. Eternal and blessed God, it is such a grand privilege tonight that we have of standing in Thy divine presence under this great tent where Your children are assembled together for no other purpose but to hear the Word and to see the moving of the living God. And we would ask tonight that You would pour out Your blessings upon us in a great way. Change our ways of thinking if they're wrong, Lord. And set our thinking on Thy Son, the Lord Jesus. May our hearts be filled with His presence. And when we leave tonight from the meeting, may we say like those who came from Emmaus, did not our hearts burn within us as He talked to us along the road? And now, Father, we pray that the Holy Spirit will just take these few words to be read and will pour out the context of them in every heart. Grant it, Lord. Help me, Father, as I'm standing here, that my soul may rejoice in Your blessed presence, while we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Tonight, to begin my part of this convention and the speaking, I have chosen a little text found over in the book of Revelation, to you who mark it. Revelation, the 3rd chapter, in the 20th verse. I wish to read this portion of the word. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and will open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and eat with me. This text of Revelation here is the message to the Laodicean church, which I truly believe that, not being the dispensationalist exactly, but yet I believe that we're at the end of the Gentile dispensation, that was told. And I believe that the Laodicean church age was the last church age. And I think that's where we are tonight. And that's why I've taken this for a text. And some might say, well, Brother Rand, isn't this rather a small text for a group of people this size and for a convention of this caliber? If you just read just a few words and one little verse of Scripture. But you see, it isn't the size of the Scripture. It isn't the size of the reading. It's what it is that counts.
Amen.
Some time ago in Louisville, Kentucky, a little friend of mine was up in the attic, an old garret in the house, and he was bumming around a little lad. He fell into an old
found an old postage stamp just about 1/2 inch square. And he thought maybe with this on his mind that ice cream might come from this stamp, so he hurries down the street to his friend that collected his old stamp, and said to this friend, "I found a little old yellow stamp. It's quite old, but I just wonder if this stamp is worth anything." And the stamp collector got his glass out and looked over a little, and he quickly said, "I'll give you a $1 bill for this certain stamp." And of course, the little lad, not expecting more than 5 cents, the sale was made quickly because that dollar meant many ice cream cones. So, after a while, about 2 weeks later, this collector sold this certain stamp for $2,500. And about 6 months later, it was sold for $500,000. And you see, it wasn't the little stamp, the little piece of paper, it's what was wrote on that paper that counted. That's the way it is with my text tonight. It isn't the paper that it's wrote on, it isn't the size of the text, but it's what's wrote on it. It's the Word of the Living God. It's so essential that all the heavens and earth will pass away, but it shall never pass away. See, God notices every little word that we read. God knows every little thought that goes through our mind, every little act that we do. And I'm kindly thinking this, that many times the church in its looseness gets to doing things and thinking things and taking things just as we are, when we ought to weigh what we do and say. We ought to think it over before we speak it. My old Southern mammy used to tell me, "Think twice and speak once." It's the little things sometimes that we leave undone that means so much to us. We get in such a hurry to race over things in this neurotic age that we live in. It would be who must ask the Church of God tonight to stop and wait a minute, see where we're at. Some time ago I was standing in Vancouver, British Columbia. And the King George of England had come over to visit Canada. And he was making his way down along the street in the carriage, and his beautiful queen sitting by him. Mr. Baxter, one of my associates, he was weeping because he said, "Just think, Brother Brent, our king passes by." And I thought, if that would make a Canadian weep, because King George, the honorable king, was passing by, what would it be when Jesus passes by? Oh, and the King of Kings, with his beautiful bride, the church.
Please.
And all the schools turned out, and the teachers give the little children a little British flag to wave their loyalty to the king as he passed by. And as the king went by, there was one of the certain schools as a little girl that did not return to her place. And the teacher, being alarmed, she rushed out in the street to find what had become of the child. And as she looked along the street, she found the little girl standing by a telegraph pole, just weeping her little heart out. So the teacher goes over to the little girl and she says, "Darling, why are you weeping so?" Said, "Did you not be able to wave your flag at the king?"
Yes.
And she said, "Yes, I waved my flag at the king, teacher." "Well," said, "did you not be able to holler, 'Hey, to the king said, yes, I ought to hail to the king's teacher. Well, said, did you not see the king? Said, yes, I saw the king's teacher. Said, well, then why are you weeping so far, darling? He said, teacher, you see, I saw the king, but I'm so little the king didn't see me. But how different it is with Jesus. You don't have to be in who's who. You don't have to have your name on some great book of some sort. No matter who you are, Jesus sees you. And knows every little act that we do. Every little thing that you do for him. Every little move that you make, he keeps it on his book. He knows all of us. Whether we are important in this world or not important, we're all important to his kingdom. Whether we are rich, poor, or indifferent. You see, this also is a pardon. A small group I've read in a scripture tonight that would close up every bootleg dark in Dallas.
Well, glory.
That would put every church that's in one another's soul, put them right back to old-fashioned fellowship and a revival. It would do it. Some time ago in the days of our most notable Abraham Lincoln, it was told that there was a prisoner in a camp that was sentenced to death by a federal crime that he had done. And some good man went and asked the president, won't you pardon this certain man? And the president Lincoln, as we all know, to be a Christian. The man said, sir, do you know the man's got a mortal soul? Are you mortal soul that you are going to take from his body? And would you take his life and his begging for mercy? Mr. Lincoln, fixing to get into his parish, just wrote a little piece and said, I pardon this man, Abraham Lincoln. And the man rushed back quickly to the prison cell and said, sir, I have your pardon from the President of the United States. And the man looked at him and said, if that was a real pardon, it would be on a great paper with a seal, and it would have all kinds of gold letters on it if it come from the president. And he said, why do you make fun of me? And knowing that I'm to be shot in the morning at sundown. He said, I'm not making fun of you, sir. This has got Abraham Lincoln's signature on it. Or he said, it isn't just enough for me to believe it. And he refused to receive it, and he was shot the next morning. Now there is a pardon at large, both by Abraham Lincoln, that this certain person was to be pardoned on this day, and a foreign squad to kill him the next day. It was tried in federal courts, and here was the decision. A pardon is not a pardon, except it be received as a pardon.
Oh,
and this is God's word that I have just read. It's a pardon to those who want to accept it as a pardon.
Amen.
And healing to those who want to accept it as
healing. Amen. Glory.
And it can be any great blessing that God has promised if we will believe it and accept it as such.
Amen.
No matter what size it is, what kind of a book it's going on, as long as it's God's eternal word. This is a very strange thing to see a man knocking on a door, to be in the scriptures. I just forget the artist's picture, the man who painted the famous picture of Jesus knocking at the door. I can't call his name, is it Grecian artist, I believe. And when all great pictures, before they can be hung in the Hall of Fame, they have to go through the Hall of Critics first. And then it just reminds me of the church. Before the church can ever be taken to glory, it has to go through the this world of criticism. to you. It's something that God has permitted to you to try you and to bring you to 100% pure gold. They're trying. All that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution, says the Scripture. So the criticism, we welcome that. Because that's what we have to put us through the fiery trial. So this artist, when this picture was going through the Hall of Critics, there was one critic said, "Sir, I think your portrait of Christ is beautiful. And I think standing at the door in the fire and his anticipation of watching and waiting that someone would open. But there's one thing wrong. That is that you haven't got any laboratory to go in at." And the artist said, "Oh, I painted it thus. You see, in this case, the latch is on the inside. You must do the opening. Christ does the knocking." And that's the way it is with every person here tonight that's seeking God for anything. He's knocking at the door, but you have to open up. You are the one that's under control. You're on the inside to open the door. If you need salvation, if you not, receive it. Open the door. If you need healing, open the door. That's all you have to do. And then he will come in. That is, you'll notice, the man knocking at a door is trying to gain entrance. And surely no man would knock at another man's door unless he had something important or something he thought was important to talk over with the man. And great man has knocked at doors down to the east. For instance, back in the days of Rome, what would have happened if the great Caesar, Augustus Caesar, would have went down to a peasant's house and would have knocked at the door? And this peasant would have come to the door. He would have seen who that great emperor was. He would have fell prostrate on his face and said, "Great man, great Augustus Caesar, come into my house." What an honor it would have been for a poor man, a peasant, that had the Emperor of Rome standing at his door. That would have been a great honor. Or in the days of the late Adolf Hitler, what if Adolf Hitler would have went down to a peasant's door, German footman, the soldier's door, and would have knocked at his door. And when this soldier opened the door and saw the great spear in Germany at that day standing at his door, he would have come to attention and would have slew him and said, "Oh, Hitler, come into my house. Anything that's in this house that you want is yours." Why? Hitler was an important man in his day, especially to a German, and the days that he was the dictator of Germany. Or I might say this, what if our great president, Dwight Eisenhower, would have come to Dallas tonight, and he could have come to the house of the best Democrat there is in Dallas, it has been an honor to you. Sure, you might have disagreed with him on politics, but Dwight Eisenhower is the president of the United States. He's a great man. It's the importance of the person at the door, not in the town. Certainly.
Right,
yeah. And so, if he come and knocked at your door and you would disagree with him, you would have said, "Now, wait a minute, Mr. Eisenhower. You just go away from my door. I'm a Democrat." "No, sir, you'd invite him in." And what would happen? Tomorrow, while Dwight Eisenhower would humble himself, he needed to be a great president. And if he would humble himself to come to your door, just an ordinary man, Why, the television was packed. All around the world tomorrow will know that Dwight Eisenhower comes to some poor man's door in Dallas, Texas. How he humbled himself to do such. Or why the queen that just visited here, she went up into Canada, the Queen of England, and she come down into the United States. What if she would have come to one of your doors you went in here? Maybe you would have looked at her and said, I don't understand who you are. If she said, I'm the Queen of England, though you're not her subject, but yet you would have been honored to have the Queen of England at your door. Any person would, because she's an important woman. She's the greatest queen on earth. Over the greatest, the greatest known queen in the earth is the Queen of England. Why, you'd have said, come in, Queen, and look over my house. And if there's anything here that you desire, you may have it. There's been a little trinket sitting on the shelf that your grandmother would have had given you. And if you'd have asked for it, you'd better have it. This call was a very important. She's a great woman. It would have been an honor to surrender this little treasure to the Queen of England. Certainly, because of her importance. But, oh, brother, sister, here's what I'm here to say. Who is more important to knock on your door than Jesus?
Amen.
And who's any more turned away than Jesus? He's turned away more than all the presidents, dictators, and kings of all the world ever turned away. Jesus has been more turned away. The queen, the dictator, might have been bringing something to you or taking something for you. But Jesus coming to your door wants to give you something, the best thing that you ever could receive.
Amen.
Eternal life.
Oh, God.
Turn from the door.
Oh, God.
Oh, it is a tragic thing. If a man or woman would only stop and think for just a moment that the King of the Lord, the King of life,
hallelujah,
the Son of the Eternal God, might get a mortal heart to give him something good in his eternal morning. Every divine promise in the Bible is yours now. If the faith of God knocks at your heart, then you can have it. Why would we weary? Why would we try to say, well, I'm just afraid it won't happen? How can we ever comprehend that in our mind when the King of Glory promises Jesus Christ, the Son of God, must stand at the door and knock. And if any man will hear him and will open the door, I'll come in and sup with him.
Hallelujah.
Now, sup in means that commune or fellowship. Jesus wants fellowship. That's what God's heart longs for tonight. He longs for his death. And every place in the world of breaking down of prejudice, of cleaning up from the pulpit all the way to the basement,
oh,
and an old-fashioned revival, well, take the nomination together and make a real church of the meeting. Take hands of the heart of the Baptists, the Methodists, the Pentecostals, the Nazarenes. He longs to gain a fellowship in his people.
Hallelujah.
Come in to commune.
Oh.
And to bring in something good.
Yeah.
But the church and the people keep him away. They're turning down. Because you say, well, that group don't believe just like I do. What difference does that make?
Amen.
That has nothing to do with it. We are a cleaning up, a house cleaning, and a real revival starts when the gifts and powers and manifestations of the Holy Spirit come to the church.
Pentecost.
Pentecostal church.
Yes,
yes. Oh, it used to be wrong for you women to cut your hair. I remember that. But then now you say, preacher, there you go, you're hitting that. All right, you see where your pride of life is? The Bible is against it.
Yes,
if the Bible said in his grandmother's days it was wrong, it's the same Bible tonight.
Praise God, it is. Hallelujah.
The Bible says when you cut your hair, a husband can divorce her. She dishonors her head.
You bet.
Now that's right.
Tough.
That's what the scripture says.
Praise God, it is.
Now there's something wrong somewhere, even in the pew or the pulpit one. That's right. Now that's true. Now notice, it used to be wrong for the ladies even to wear the skirt lower, you in the front and up like that, but now they the Pentecostal women wear
sharp.
Now that's right. What are you doing, Paul? Well, you say, I don't wear a damn, I wear a slack. That's worse. Do you know the Bible said that a woman that will put on a garment that pertains to a man is an abomination to
yes,
the
sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Praise God.
Do you have a healing service to the great revival? Therefore, the sins at the door. That's where it's at. You say, well, I belong to this. That don't have nothing to do with it. It's Christ doing his work.
Praise God. Hallelujah.
Some of these little old dirty looking clothes that women wear. What do you say to me, Brother Ben? That's the only kind they sell, but they still sell sewing machines and goods. And let me ask you something, sister. Do you know what you're going to be guilty of at the day of the judgment for committing adultery with sinners?
Yes.
The Bible says, Jesus, our blessed Lord, said, whosoever looketh upon a woman to lust after her has committed adultery with her in his heart already. And if you present yourself like that, you may be as pure as a lily to your husband or your boyfriend. But Jesus says that you've committed adultery with the sinner that you have presented yourself to him.
Yes.
Now Jesus said that.
Yes.
Who's guilty? You're presenting yourself like that.
Yes.
Now you say, Brother Ben, you're picking on the women. All right, you men. And any man that'll let his wife smoke cigarettes and wear those kind of clothes, it shows what you're made out of.
Yes, sir. Got them good.
The ruler of the house. What happened? You can't take American homes. No wonder we got juvenile delinquency.
Yes,
we got parents delinquency. We got church delinquency. What do we have? That's true. Not to hurt you. But to tell you the truth, we got to clean up.
Yes.
We got to have a revival.
Yes.
And get all the bugs out of the thing before we, God will ever come in.
Yes.
And absolutely say you're in a funeral, not proud of life. There it is.
Yes.
Well, then you have another little door called pride. Oh, my. Don't get happy with that. Now, look, Brother Bam, I think it's so much to me. All right. It's your pride in life. You say you got no business busting it on my pride of life. That's what you're telling Christ. I'm talking from the Word. The Word speaks for itself. Right. Pride of life. Just me and the Joneses, you know. Me and my denomination. You've got no right to draw denominational lines of brotherhood.
Amen.
Right. Right, you might differ on doctrines and so forth, which is all right. Might carry find somebody to eat the apple, but we're eating pie just the same. We got no right to draw lines just because the fellow don't believe with you. You're saying church the denomination with you. So I'm a Baptist, I'm telling you, I don't go for them holy rollers. You never go to heaven, you're going to go with them. You're going to be plenty of man. There you are. See, you let him in, you let him save you from hell, but you won't let him be your Lord. Lord means rulership. Lord means ownership. When he comes in, let him be your Lord. Just straight up dances to Jake Graham. I was at his breakfast in Louisville after his great meeting there. So I heard the man get up. And he took the Bible and he said, this is the example, which is correct exactly. He said, when Paul went into a city and he had a revival, said he'd come back about a year later and that one soul he got saved has got 30 more saved. He said, I go into a city and have a revival and have 20,000 saved and go back 6 weeks later and can't find 20. What's the matter? Here's the matter. They just get enthused with the evangelism and a big crowd of people. That's all.
Amen.
Exactly. And the Pentecostals are getting to be the same. What we need is Christ being Lord. That there's a little door called faith, which we had time to open all these doors. But I want to overlook this little door of faith. You know, you say, well, now I've got faith, Brother Branham. I let Jesus come into my heart. You thought you'd done him an honor. Sometimes you act like it. Oh, what a great thing you did when you let Jesus come to the door and stand there. You won't stand very long, don't you, Will? I wouldn't stand long, and you wouldn't stand long in my house if I said, come to stand here a few moves, don't you go fool anything out here. You know you wasn't welcome. That's the reason you're 20 out of 20,000. Now we need to let him in, and when he comes in, worship him and say, come in, Lord! Be my Savior, be my God, be my ruler, be my healer, be my, be all I want is so nice. Be my Lord, take everything that I've got, Lord, and rule it. Take my emotions, I'll not be ashamed anymore. Take my prayer, stand in the door and walk me, Lord, with your word. Stand in my private life, Lord. Make me what you want me to be. Let me not take my own thoughts, but take your thoughts. Heed me, O Lord. You'll never take me from the Word. You'll keep your eye in His Word. Not because the Baptist, you're the Pentecost, you're the Presbyterian, but because God's Word says so, you believe it. Man is ever born of the Spirit of God. He's something that he never gets away from. There's no man got a right to preach the gospel until first he's been on the sacred sands of the back side of the desert. There's theologians in this world that smart and shrewd and can explain everything away. Take everything away, even the whole Bible. They might switch your mind and everything else. But if you ever let God come into your heart fully and get that back out of the desert experience, then brother, all devils out of hell can come on that ground that you said. It's something that's real. This little door of faith. Or you say, preacher, I know you people believe in divine healing, but my faith don't teach that, then you've got the wrong faith. Right. See, if you let Jesus come in, you won't no more say the days of miracles are past. Right. Jesus is in there, and He is the miracle. He's the miracle performer. And the miracle is that there in your heart, that your presence, as it was when you walked scattered.
Glory. Praise God.
He's there. That's the reason people won't let him in. Let him stand in that door one time. Use God's faith. It's yours. If you you've been born again and that Christ in the door, he'll stand right at the door and say, I am the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Yes.
Right. Every word that I said, part of it. I'm your Savior, I'm your King, I'm your healer, I'm your joy, I'm the fountains of life, I'm Alpha, Omega, I'm your getting up at morning, I'm your going to bed at night.
Hallelujah.
As David said, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil,
praise
for
God
is with me.
Hallelujah.
I'd make my bed in hell, he would be there.
Oh, God.
Oh, we need an old-fashioned revival.
Yeah.
True. Notice now just another thing. He's sitting here to this Laodicean church age that we're now living in. He said, I counsel you to come and buy from me fine gold. But you say that you are rich. How rich is the church today? The greatest buildings it ever had, the most money it ever had. You say, I'm rich, and I have need of nothing. And you don't know that you're naked, miserable, blind, poor, and wretched, and don't know it. What is it? I am, don't know it. Now, if you've seen a man coming down the street that was wretched, naked, blind, and you can run in and say, sir, you're naked. Oh, I am, sir. Well, then how can you help me? I've got help for you here. And come in right quick, let me clothe you. Well, if he would listen to you, all right. But what if the man's in that condition and doesn't know it? And the Bible said that this last church age would be that way. Now, you Pentecostal people, you've got the best churches you ever had. And you'd be a lot better off down on the mission, but on the street down here with a little tin pan beating on the drums or something like that, calling sinners to repent, there wouldn't be any such churches you got turning into bars.
Thank you, man. Thank
you, man. You know that, right?
Amen.
Now, I don't mean to hurt your feelings. I'm your brother.
Right.
And I'm just telling you the truth. So, ladies and gentlemen, that's the reason I said about you women. Making all yourself up. You Pentecost women wearing that manicure over your face, you know. Or that's the stuff I don't want it in. You don't need that. You're okay. That's of the devil.
Amen.
Let me tell you, there's only one woman in the Bible ever painted her face.
Yes.
And her name was Jezebel.
Amen.
And God said her to the dog.
Amen.
So you see, a dog needs to change the face like that. Now, we have for no joke. This is not a place to joke for you.
Amen.
I'm just telling you the truth.
Amen.
It's a human race. What happened? Now, it says that miserable, wretched, blind, and don't know it. I was raised in Kentucky in a little clapboard shingle house, and Mama used to take all us little brands and stick us all in one bed, about 3 at the foot and 3 at the head, and about 3 more across the middle. And she would, and we had just an old piece of canvas she would put over top of the bed to keep the snow and rain out of her eyes. And the draft would come through, and at nighttime when that cold wind would come through, and sometimes Mama called it matter, cold getting in her eyes. Then it'd stick her eyes together. And I was the oldest, and she'd say, Billy, come on down. I'd say, Mommy, I can't see. My eyes are stuck together. And my little brother Edward, he'd say, I can't see either, Mommy. You see, we caught cold in our eyes. And it got infection. And it stuck her eyelids together. And my grandpa was a coon hunter. And he used to catch coons, raccoons, and take them out, and he would wriggle the grease out of them. And Mama would go get that old pan, set it on the stove, that coon grease. She'd get real good and hot and come up there and massage her eyes. And allowed it to get open. I don't know what happened, but it softened up the matter in her eyes, and we could see. I tell you, brother, there's been a cold spell in the church. can see, we've had a little draft come across the church somewhere. I think we got to breaking up and making I'm this and I'm that. I wonder what we are after all. Oh, if you only knew it, friend. Your sons and daughters of God that got trying to get. You just got your eyes mattered. That's all. God, thank you too bad is what we want. And if we finally have to get the eyes open up.
Praise God.
Look around. See how good God did to us. I stand at the door and knock. And if any man will hear my voice, open up the door, I'll come in commune with him. If the Baptist will hear it, if the Methodist will hear it, if the Pentecost will hear it, if the Nazarene, the Pilgrim Holiness, I'll come in and I'll put a little grease over your eyes and open up your eyes to let you see where we're at. Oh, you know, the Pentecostal church has had a revival. When this little minister a while ago, the little Jewish brother here, that introduced me about spearheading the revival, we've had a wonderful revival. I don't know when ever in history there's been a revival like this Pentecostal age. That's right, there's revival, fire burning every nation out of heaven tonight.
Right.
That's right. We're in the end time. It's wonderful. And we, let me say to you people here in Dallas, a headquarters of these great churches, these great people. Now, don't feel bad because I say these things like I've been saying. I'm saying it for your good and for the good of the gospel, friends. Now, look, then we can have real healing services. Then we can have something real take place when we break down our little walls and straighten up ourselves and wash our faces and shave ourselves, come to and hear the cross. Right. Then God will bless you.
Amen.
Then the songs of Zion will return the old-fashioned blessings that we long for. God, just the Pentecostal skies are full of it. Why accept a substitute when the real things are at hand? No need. But you know what? That we have seen so much until we've lost the value of what we got.
Right.
One time there was a man going down to the sea. He wanted a little rest. He never saw the sea. He'd been raised in more or less a desert country, and he was on his road to the sea. And he said, I'm going down. I just long to smell the salt air and see the great flying waves as he leap into the air and break, and the heavens blue shining down on the briny water to make them blue. Hear the wild screams of the seagulls as they circle over the sea. I long to hear it and to see it. It'll be so restful for me, for I have heard that such things exist. So he made ready to go to the seashore. Just before he got to the seashore, he met an old salt returning, which means an old sailor. And he said, where goest thou, my good man? He said, I go to the seashore, sir. He said, I go to see the great waves and explain to him how his heart would be thrilled to only see those things. And the old salt said, now I was born on that sea. He said, I was born in a ship. He said, I watched those waves for 40 years and heard those dull howls. I don't see nothing exciting about it. You see, you thought so much had become common. That's the way with divine healing. Someone told me a little preacher prayed for a little girl here yesterday, and 2 or 3 inches grew onto her leg.
My God.
Mercy, thou art to set this place of God. The King is here, the great mighty Christ of God who rules the heavens and earth is in presence and can do great and mighty things if you just believe.
Amen.
Don't you believe it?
Amen.
Don't you believe it? Believe it. Have faith and say, God, if you just open our eyes tonight, let us see your glory. Follow up on us, then we'll see great things. But how can you do it unless our eyes come open? Isn't that right?
Right.
We have to have it. And we see so many great miracles take place that we see people shout and praise the Lord, and yet we just fail to look at it. Isn't that right?
Yeah.
Really? Great, mighty movie. It becomes common to us. Just so common that we don't pay any attention. some time ago down Louisiana, or I believe it was Georgia, an old colored preacher that I know. He was a great old man, great soul. But he had an old man that went to, his wife went to church, and she was a godly, saintly old woman. She said that she'd prayed for her husband a long time, but his name was Gabriel, but they called him Gabe for short, so they just couldn't get old Gabe straightened out. Somehow or another, they couldn't get him straightened out with the church and with God. And so this old colored preacher taken old Gabe hunting with him many times, and they go out and hunt. So one day they've been hunting, and on the road back, old both of them had rats and birds that hanged over until they couldn't even walk hardly, just so loaded down. They was coming along a certain old familiar path. And as they walked along this path, the parson kept looking back towards the west as the sun was setting. And brother, I'm telling you, the church ought to know that it's sunsetting. The sun's going down. What these blessings that we see? What did the prophet say? It'll be light in the evening time. What kind of light? How does the sun travel? It gradually rises in the east and sets in the west.
Right.
And civilization rolls in the east and travels westward. The east and west have met together. I'll preach on that this week, the Lord willing. Now, notice, and the same light, when the sun comes up, it shines on the east, the same sun shines in the west. You get it? The Bible said, or the prophet said, there will be a day that wouldn't be day or night, a dismal time. Just a dismal time. We've had enough light to join church and build an organization and find churches. We've had that for 2,000 years. But God promised in the evening time it would be light. And what is it? The same light that fell on the Orient. The same Holy Ghost that fell on Pentecost. Bringing the same result. It's falling on the Western people today, bringing the same result that it brought back there. It'll be light. And as he was looking towards the west, the old darky walking along there, he touched the parson on the shoulder. The preacher looked around and seen the old Gabe, and the tears were running down his cheek. And he said, "Parson, today is Saturday. And tomorrow morning you're going to find me at the mourner's bench. And I'm going to get me a seat to the side of my dear wife back there in that church. There I'll remain faithful till God takes my life." The parson was so happy to hear that. He said, "Gabe, you know that I appreciate that. I'd love to hear you say that, Gabe. But what caused a sudden change? Was it the sermon I preached? Was it the things that I've talked to you about the goodness of the Lord?" He said, "No, Parson. Coming out around that bend, and now I felt something knock at my heart." He said, "You know, Parson, I couldn't hear a barn." He said, "I'm the poorest shot in the country. And that just look hanging on me at the rabbits and birds that I got myself." He said, "He must love me or he wouldn't have given to me. A little simple thing like that can a knock of Christ at the heart. Gabe, I was on your gun sight today. What about you tonight? What about you that drove up a nice car? What about you that go to fine churches? What about you that's sitting here in good health, not like that little child laying there twisting around on a clock? What about you, young lady, that's sitting here in good health, that led a little sick girl in the building there, little spastic looking child girl? Don't you know that God docked it on your heart to say it's good to see you? This is goodness. You eat your Sunday dinner yesterday. I stood a few months ago in Bombay, India. Well, I was preaching to nearly half a million souls and seeing that little mother with the little baby and the little daddy swelled out dying with hunger. But your garbage that you raked out on the can would see them.
Yeah. Amen.
Don't you know that God's knocking at your heart? And hearing you. You say, well, how about the church, Brother Ben? Prejudice? Indifference? The doors closed? Oh, if this entire group of about 1,000 people here tonight, so maybe not so many, if you would open every door in your heart to Jesus Christ now, there'd be a revival breakthrough in these next few nights. That newspaper headline, Christ would come. He wants that. That God's desire tonight above everything is to have his church won. Not in a church won. Fine ministers, fine clothes, fine cars, fine jobs. No wonderful Christ sending us it over. Why don't you let him in? Let him come in. Let us bow our heads just a moment. Let every eye be closed, if you will. I just wonder, just before we have prayer, if there's some in here would raise your hand and say, Brother Branham, I raise my hand to you. I'm raising it to God because I felt that somewhere along the last few days I've heard a little knocking on my door. I haven't lived the life that I should, Brother Branham. I've been prejudiced. I'm a church member. I should have done better. I know I should. I've busted my neighbors. I've argued with different churches about their doctrine. I've lived the way I should. I know I shouldn't have done the things that I've done, but by God's grace, I'm going to let the doors open tonight. I'm going to let him be my Lord from this hour on. And I'm going to mean this, Brother Branham. I'm not raising my hand to you. I'm raising my hand to Christ. I will come, Lord. Let me remember in prayer. Quietly now, while everybody's in prayer. Would you just raise your hands all over the building? Go on.